everyone, and welcome to another podcast episode. My name is Lucy Challenger, and I'm the CEO of Polo and Tweed, and welcome to the Voice of Luxury. Now, today, I am absolutely over the moon to be joined by Jacqui Ross. Jacqui, hello, how are you?
Hi, Lucy. I'm fine, thank you. How are you?
Very well, thank you. Now, for everyone who's tuning in, Jacqui's official title is the Regional Business Transformation Manager, and she specialises in the waste and recycling industry. Now, before I sort of hand over to Jacqui just to tell us a little bit about herself, I think many of us, all of us, every human around the world knows that we have bins, we have recycling, we have, you know, daily activities in our lives, but often, for want of a pun, it's a bit of a dirty word. We don't talk about our rubbish, we don't talk about where it goes, where it comes from, you know. Yes, more and more we become aware of it, but I find this conversation that we're about to have so fascinating. Now, Jacqui and I go back to university days. We know each other very well, and I've been a fan of her career and followed her path. But Jacqui, for everyone listening, I wondered if you could just share a little bit about your career, your history, and where you've come to now.
Yes, of course. So I would agree with you. I think a lot of people don't think about waste and recycling at all. I'd love to say that I grew up with a really defined career plan in mind and that I dreamt of working in this industry, but I fell into the industry, to be honest. I'm very glad that I did because I love working here. But I finished university with a psychology degree and needed a job, basically. So I started looking for graduate level jobs. And what actually attracted me wasn't specifically industry, but it was a really great graduate scheme that was on offer, because I had absolutely no idea what I wanted to do. And the scheme gave me the chance to work in loads of different parts of the business. So HR, finance, operations, marketing, sales. So for someone like me who had no plan in mind, that was a really good plan. So I just wanted to be honest about that, because I sometimes feel like there's a lot of pressure on people to have their lives completely mapped out. Sure. So yeah, I joined the waste industry on the graduate scheme, and luckily at the end of the scheme decided I really liked the industry. And then I applied to continue working in the industry in operations. Okay. And what I mean by that is starting to manage and then working my way up to higher level management of our operational facilities, the facilities that actually process the waste that we all produce.
Okay.
So I worked in operations for quite a while, which meant I got to learn a lot about the industry and the technology. And now my role is more looking at business improvement, which I find really fascinating. So I use a methodology called Lean Six Sigma, which, for anybody that hasn't heard of it, is basically a set of tools that you can use to help improve processes to make them more efficient, reduce waste, and make sure you're doing exactly what the customer is paying you to do. So that's not a waste industry thing. That could be applied to any sort of different industry.
Okay.
But I think working in operations first really helped with being able to then go on and do what I really love now, which is all about trying to improve what we do.
Sure, sure. And I must imagine that, you know, you must have seen the industry dramatically change over the years, because, you know, recycling was a term that I know when I was young was not really used much in our vocabulary. And now, you know, we're always looking for the green approach to things and how we can have less waste and not put things into landfill. But for people listening in, you know, who might never have thought about what happens when that bin person collects their rubbish, what actually happens? Where does it go? How is it, you know, what magic happens to it that we don't literally think about?
Yeah, that's a really good question, actually. There isn't a really simple answer for it, though. So each different part of the country in the UK decides how they want to handle their waste.
Okay.
So what happens to your waste won't be exactly the same as what happens to my waste, because we live in different parts of the country. But in general, most people have got their black bag waste that gets collected and then their recycling waste that gets collected.
Okay.
And that'll get collected by either the council or a company like I work for, and we'll take that waste and we'll tip it in a huge pile in one of our facilities, and then it'll go through some sort of process. So when I first joined the industry, you're right, it wasn't something that we really thought of, and an awful lot of our waste just went into landfill, basically a big hole in the ground. We just buried it and then forgot about it, which isn't the best method for dealing with our waste. But that's really what happened. And over the last sort of 10 years or so, it's been a really interesting transformation to moving as far away as we can from landfill and waste to recycling and recovering whatever we can. Okay. So what probably happens to our waste at the moment, firstly, we'll all be taking out much more recyclable material than we ever were before. And the black bag waste, some of it might still go to landfill, but that hopefully is a minority. Some of it might go to be burnt in our energy from waste facilities where it'll produce electricity.
Oh, wow.
And some of it might go through a slightly different process. For example, we actually shred a lot of black bag waste and then remove the kind of food and organic content that people might have still put in and remove some of the metal and bale it. And a lot of that actually gets shipped over to Northern Europe.
Wow. And what do they do with our waste? What do they do with that content that you've shredded and sent over to them?
I know, it doesn't sound like a very great thing. But Northern Europe obviously is a lot colder than the UK. And waste is a really good fuel source. You know, we burn coal or wood to make electricity for our heating and things. So why not burn waste? You know, we've got to do something with it. So they'll burn that waste that we send over and they'll produce electricity and they'll also produce steam.
Okay.
And what they do that's quite clever is called district heating. And it basically means that houses or businesses that are close to the facility that burns the waste can benefit from quite cheap heating, but steam, hot steam, doesn't travel very far. So you've got to be really close to do that. Whereas the electricity can just be exported to the national grid.
Wow.
And so they don't have enough of their own waste. They literally run out of waste. That's why we ship ours over there.
Oh, I see, because they have less population and therefore producing less waste and potentially are recycling more also. So are they paying us for that waste? Are we selling it to them?
It depends on the deal that's been done. So generally, it would be cheaper for us to send that waste to them than an equivalent in the UK, which might be landfilling it. So we're not sending it out of the goodness of our hearts, but it will be a cheaper alternative. And one of the reasons for that is over the last probably more than 10 years, the government in the UK has been gradually putting a tax on landfill. So each year, the tax that you've got to pay for every ton of material that gets landfilled has gone up. And the goal of that has been to try and make that a less attractive proposition. And it gives recycling or other solutions. It makes them more viable in terms of the cost.
Okay. And, you know, this might seem like an odd question, but surely we have a certain landmass in the United Kingdom, and at a certain point we're going to run out of places to bury things. I mean, where are landfill sites? I mean, I've never seen one. Are they the mounds that you see on the motorway that you drive past? I mean, where are these magical places that we've chucked rubbish in, and then what happens next?
There's probably some closer to you than you think. So I guess in the UK, we have way less landfills that are open and in use than we used to, because we've been quite successful in reducing the amount that we landfill. But they do still exist. And I think if you were close enough to one, you definitely know it was there. Okay. But they're usually quite well disguised. You know, they're not in people's backyards usually. So that's probably why you've never noticed. And once they've finished filling the hole in the ground, we call it capping it off. So it will be covered in grass and it will be, in essence, turned back into something that people can use. So a lot of the time that they could be turned into like a recreational facility, for example, or a park.
Oh, wow.
You do have to be careful what you do in terms of building on a closed landfill site, for example, because it is rubbish that we've buried in the ground. Yeah. So I don't want to make it sound like because we cover it over with grass, that therefore landfill's not something that we should be worried about, because we definitely don't want to have a lot of landfill.
Yeah, no, I completely get that, 100%. So you've spoken about the process that sort of our normal black bin rubbish goes through, but what about recycling? Because I have good friends in Austria who I think you've possibly met at some point. And when I was spending a lot of time out with them, I was absolutely, you know, blown away by the amount of recycling they did. Literally everything is recycled, bar maybe a few tiny things. And what I found fascinating was any rubbish that they had left over, they had to take to their local rubbish place and it was weighed, and then they were charged for this rubbish. So for an average person in Austria, they are incentivized to recycle, because otherwise they have a bill to pay. And it made total sense. I mean, it was a pain in the butt, to be perfectly frank, because absolutely everything had to go in its own little box, and then you had to take it out, and then, you know, so it was a lot of time for me to do it. But in terms of the environment and, you know, the output of waste, it was a phenomenal idea. So here, of course, and in different areas, they have different types of recycling, and different councils are perhaps more progressive than others. But what happens to our recycling when the recycling ladies and chaps pick it up? What happens next?
So in general, it'll be taken to a processing facility, like one that I used to run, for example. And in those facilities, the material, the sort of most of the recycling we do in the UK is mixed together by the householders. I know some people separate it, but in general, a lot of it's mixed. So we have to separate it out is the first step.
Wow.
So it goes through, we call them a MRF, usually a material recycling facility. And if you imagine a load of conveyor belts, the material gets loaded on at one end and it travels along the conveyor belts, and it'll go through a combination of technology and people literally picking from the conveyor belt.
Wow.
I think a lot of people don't realize that we hand sort a lot of material from households. And between the technology and the people, we'll separate out whatever you've put in your commingled bin into a pile of one particular type of plastic, a pile of paper, a pile of aluminium cans. Mm-hmm. And that's the first step, really, is just separating it into the different sources. Okay. And from there, that material usually goes to a company that actually use that material to turn it into a new product. So for example, plastic, we might send a bale of plastic bottles. That'll go to a site where they might turn those into pellets, and then those would go to a company that will use those pellets to make it into something like more plastic or a fleece. You can make fleeces out of plastic. So there's quite a few stages to it, and we're kind of the first stage of just cleaning it up and separating it out.
Okay, I see. And you use the word cleaning it up. So, I mean, I've seen, you know, friends, family members maybe have a glass jar of honey or something that could be recycled because it's glass, and they haven't necessarily washed it out. They've put it straight in the recycling. So, I mean, from an expert perspective, is that not great? Should we be, you know, cleaning these products, or is there a process that deals with that at the point that it's going into the sorting?
It's not great. It's probably the honest answer.
Okay.
If you think whatever you put into your bin is sort of getting picked up by a bin wagon, and it's getting mixed up with what your neighbours have put into their bin. So if you've put, for example, a cardboard pizza box,
yeah,
in your bin, but it's dirty and it's covered in delicious tomato cheesy pizzaness, that's getting mixed up with lots of other people's waste, and your neighbour's clean paper that they've put in their bin will now be dirty paper. So it's quite important to realise that the impact of what you put in your bin, it impacts the whole load that's being collected. All we do is sort the material, but it does need to be fairly clean. So yeah, if you've got a dirty jar of honey or your pizza box, that the contents of that are in essence going to get mixed onto the clean material. And a lot of the reprocessors can't take dirty material. So we have a problem in the industry in that we might have a bin wagon arrives on the site and it's half contaminated. And that's often material that shouldn't be in there at all. It never ceases to amaze me how many people put dirty nappies into their commingled bin. It's a favourite location for dirty nappies in the UK, but that could just be dirty material. So it is really important. They don't have to be spotless, you don't have to scrub them, but relatively clean.
Wow, that is incredible. And it really shows you that there's still a general lack of understanding when it comes to recycling. And there's a breakdown somewhere between either council and individual or the government and the individual to understanding how we should be recycling and what you can and can't put in the recycling, like you mentioned about the dirty nappies. So, I mean, just sort of taking an overview of your career so far, and, you know, this is such an interesting conversation we're having. You know, you've been in the waste industry and recycling industry, you've seen it develop and change. What is it about it that makes you want to get up every day and you know, go to work and meet these new challenges? What do you find exciting about your industry at the moment?
That's a good question. I think there's a couple of things for me. So overall, I really like working in an industry where I feel like what we do matters. You know, the environment is really, really important. You know, we've only got one planet, and I like feeling like what I'm doing in some small way contributes to that, and that I work for an ethical company and our goal, you know, is for the greater good, so to speak. Mm. So I think at a high level, that motivates me.
Yeah.
For my actual job, you know, I said I work in a sort of process improvement team. And I think on a day-to-day basis, the thing that really motivates me is I like seeing the results. I work on quite a lot of projects, mm-hmm. and they have a sort of beginning and an end. And at the end of the project, I can kind of look back and think, that's what we've achieved. There's a tangible something that's been improved. Yeah. And the projects that I like working on the most, and it's probably the thing that motivates me, is I really, really like working on a project that's going to make people's jobs easier. Yeah. Because a lot of the time I think people think of lean or process improvement as just being about making a process better and making more money for the company. But a lot of the time we're actually focusing on making your job life better. And because I do that within a company rather than as a consultant, I know those people. Yeah. So for me, that's, you know, really nice feeling like I can make a difference to those people.
Yeah. Oh, that's so lovely. It is wonderful to, I think, work for ethical companies and really feel like you're making a difference to the environment. But, you know, speaking about environment, I think it's hard. I use myself as an example, because I go and buy something and, you know, the bananas are wrapped up in plastic and the strawberries are in plastic and more plastic, you know, and it's quite hard to buy something that has less packaging unless you go to literally a zero waste shop. So how can we, you know, the general people, be more environmentally friendly without, you know, having to go to the nth of our lives, particularly at the current period of lockdown, etc.? How can we be more environmentally friendly?
Yeah, that's a good question. And it's not actually that easy. You know, for something that's so important, you'd think we'd have made it easy for ourselves. And I think, as you've sort of mentioned, you know, any of us can look at something and think, oh, I could choose that broccoli that hasn't got plastic wrapped around it instead of the broccoli with plastic wrapped around it. So I think wherever it's possible to, just keep in mind what might be the more environmentally friendly option. But like you said, sometimes it's really not easy to tell. And even for me, you know, when I work in the industry, sometimes I find myself weighing up what's the best option here. So, for example, one of the things that I think is quite interesting is we've phased out plastic bags, single-use plastic bags in supermarkets, you know, unless you really request them. Mm. And we all think, oh, that's really great. And it is, you know, we're definitely reducing plastic. But actually, if you're using a reusable plastic bag, there's been more resource and more energy put into making that reusable plastic bag. Mm. So unless you're actually going to reuse it, you'd probably be better off with the cheap thin plastic bag. So I think people do need to weigh up some of the eco alternatives. They're definitely eco alternatives, but only if you're actually going to keep reusing them.
Yeah.
So I think things like that, everybody can bear in mind. But the government is working towards something that should help make it a little bit more obvious to us. Have you heard anything about the extended producer responsibility scheme?
No.
Probably not if you're not in the industry. So this isn't actually legislation yet. It's only part of a consultation. I think it's been a little bit delayed by COVID. I think maybe next year, hopefully some of these things might start to be a reality.
Yeah.
But it's basically aiming to make the producers of whatever it is you're buying responsible for the disposal of it at the end of its life. So that doesn't mean that, you know, curries, for example, are suddenly going to start disposing of waste themselves, but it more means they'd be financially responsible. So by making the producers financially responsible for the cost of disposing of the waste instead of the local authority at the moment, the idea is it would give them more of an incentive to think about disposal when they're designing the product. Because there's so many ways that we could make the products that we buy easier and more environmentally friendly to dispose of.
Yeah.
So that's really the overall aim of that. And the other thing that they're thinking about as part of that scheme, which would make it easier for you to spot what might be the more environmentally friendly thing to buy, is, you know, on food at the moment that you buy from the supermarket, you can tell how healthy it is by looking at the nutritional analysis.
Sure.
So there is a school of thought that they could do something similar for how environmentally friendly it is. Yeah. So you could see that this product has much more environmentally friendly packaging than another product without necessarily needing to be a scientist or work in the waste industry. So I don't know if that will happen, but it's definitely one of the proposals, which I think would be great.
I love that. I think that's so key to put the responsibility onto the producer, right? Because then it makes total sense. It's sort of, you know, you and I can go to our local supermarket and say, please stop wrapping the broccoli in plastic. It doesn't need to be wrapped in plastic. But unless everyone was to do that, are they going to change? Probably not. Whereas what you're suggesting the government's talking about will incite that change.
Yeah, definitely. And I think as well, the other aim of the scheme is, because the producers would be paying the cost of disposal, the idea is that that money would be invested into infrastructure in the UK, so that then we'd be able to start developing more advanced recycling methods. Like you mentioned a few minutes ago about in Europe, you know, they do have a tendency to recycle a lot more than we do, and we need that infrastructure.
No, it's fascinating. It's really interesting. So obviously you've been in this industry since you were a graduate, and you've worked up the hierarchy in the company you work with, and you now have a senior position. But I assume along the way you undertook a lot of training, sort of learning on the job, but also educational. I mean, how much importance do you put on, I don't know, your degree through to actually learning on the job and training that you've undertaken? Do you still do training courses now? I mean, how much are you actively relearning?
Yeah, funnily enough, I have actually just last week started a new training course. I've just started doing an MBA.
Oh, how exciting.
I know, it's slightly overwhelming, but quite exciting to start.
Wow. How long is that course going to be? How long is it going to take you to complete?
That's 2 years, part-time. Okay. And that's kind of like a senior leader course. Okay. So it isn't something that you'd want to undertake when you'd literally just started your career. So I think, you know, I think there's always something to learn. And I have undertaken a lot of training, but it's all been through the company. So for example, when you're working in operations, running waste facilities, you have to have what we call a COTC or a WAMI-TAB qualification. And it basically means that you're competent and responsible for running those facilities. Mm-hmm. And it's like an MVQ style qualification, but it can take people a couple of years to obtain it. Mm-hmm. So that's probably the most common qualification if you're actually involved in running the facilities. But again, you couldn't get that in advance. You know, I couldn't have done that at university. It's a kind of on the job training scheme.
Okay, I see. And speaking of that, obviously, you know, I see the waste industry and recycling industry as something that is literally part of humanity, because as humans, we create waste, we hopefully recycle. But, you know, it's up there with working in the funeral trade, as it were. You know, it's a certainty, it's going to happen. But if someone's listening to this and thinking, well, how do I get into this world? Obviously, you went through a graduate scheme. What would be your advice to someone who wanted to learn more or work within the waste and recycling industry?
Okay, yeah, so I joined on a graduate scheme. So like you said, having a degree was essential for me because that's the only way onto a graduate scheme. So that's definitely one way into the industry. However, at the moment, apprenticeships are a really big thing at the moment, and they're a great opportunity. And I think if I was just starting out in my career, I'd consider looking for a really good apprenticeship with a waste management company, because that way you're gaining a qualification and your apprenticeships can be at any level, and you're also learning on the job and being paid. So I think that's at the moment a really nice way into the industry. You definitely don't need a degree to enter the waste industry unless you're looking for a specific role, for example, you know, an engineer who would require an engineering degree. So I think an apprenticeship you could definitely consider. And for people that really don't think education is for them, lots of people in this industry just start at the bottom, you know, sort of manual labour on one of our facilities. And it's quite a good industry in terms of if you've sort of got the ability, there's generally quite a lot of opportunities to work your way up that way. And along the way, you'll probably have to undertake some training at the same time. So there's a few ways in. I'd be inclined to look at an apprenticeship if I was starting out now.
Well, that's really good advice. Thank you for sharing that to our listeners. So, you know, earlier you mentioned the dirty nappy, which fills me with dread because I remember the dirty nappies. You'll be pleased to hear I never put them in the recycling. They went firmly
into the
bag bin. But, you know, over the course of your career, fascinating career, you must have seen some unusual or perhaps funny experiences. I mean, without, you know, saying anything that you don't want to, is there any particular moments that you could tell the listeners about?
Yeah, definitely. I'll give you a positive and a negative.
Okay, start with the negative and then we finish with the positive.
So I think, unfortunately, one of the most shocking things that I've experienced is when I was working in operations and I started running one of our facilities that processes the commingled recycling waste from people's houses, I was really, really shocked. I have already said by what comes through on the conveyor belt in terms of the dirty nappies. But the other thing that happens a lot more often than you'd think is the number of dead animals that seem to appear. I know, to a normal person, you'd think, why would you put that in your recycling bin? But I remember my stomach turning over the first time that I saw, you know, the dead animals, and also the number of needles that people put in their commingled bin.
Wow.
And, you know, the poor guys or girls that work in those facilities, you know, they're picking through material by hand. So I think that's, I'd like to say it's unusual, but it's not really, but it's quite shocking. And so that still really sticks in my mind.
And is it, I mean, without getting into too much of a morbid conversation about this, but is it, you know, a hedgehog or an animal that might have been hit by a car? Or is it, I mean, are people putting their pets into the recycling?
A real mixture.
Wow.
A real mixture.
Gosh.
I have no idea why. I mean, in the industry, you know, we ask ourselves this all the time, you know, and sometimes I think, do people run out of space in their black bag bin? Is it just they filled that bin and now they need to fill the recycling bin? I really have no idea.
Or maybe they think that recycling is somehow being burnt or incinerated or something to recycle it in some way. So they assume that if they put a human, or not human, hopefully, but animal... That's a
Luckily,
whole
I've never seen a human body on the belt.
That's a whole other conversation. That if they put the animal product into the recycling, that it's burnt in some way or it goes into an incinerator or something. I mean, the mind boggles. That is quite a dark subject. Moving on to a more positive one, can you tell me anything more funny, perhaps?
Yeah, I think this is fairly unusual, but one of the really nice things is one of the jobs that I've had, I've run some household waste recycling centres, you know, where members of the public can go and bring their waste if it doesn't fit in their weed bin.
Sure.
And it's quite amazing the number of times people accidentally throw their keys or, you know, the crown jewels or something accidentally into the skip.
Yeah.
And then they realise sometime later what they've thrown out. And we normally get a panicked phone call saying, could you look for such and such? And it's quite difficult to find. I mean, if the item's been thrown into the skip, and they've told us quickly enough, then you're only searching through a skip. But yeah. a lot of the time, they haven't realised until that skip's already been tipped in a pile of other waste.
Oh, wow.
But one of the nicest memories I've got of working on those sites was somebody who had accidentally thrown out a box that contained some war medals that had belonged to a relative of theirs who had died, and some jewellery as well, which I think had also belonged to a relative that had died. So it was valuable, but it was sentimentally really, really valuable. And to be honest, we didn't think we had a hope of finding these items. But I think the story really tugged at the heartstrings, and the team put an awful lot of effort in and miraculously managed to find the items. And miraculously, they weren't damaged because, you know, we don't exactly handle the waste gently after it's been thrown away. Sure. So reuniting that owner with their prized possessions is a Aww. Really nice memory.
Oh, that's wonderful. Oh, that's so lovely. Yes, I can imagine people probably do sort of throw things away by mistake and then realise they've thrown away something of value. So obviously we're in a national lockdown again. I lose track of how many we've had so far. You know, COVID impacted the world. It changed the world. It made us all suddenly having to, you know, and I can imagine your factory workers on the process line having to be socially distanced where it's not maybe not possible, and all these things changed. So how did COVID affect the waste and recycling industry?
Yeah, it's a good question. I think we've been a little bit in the middle, really, in terms of, I know some people work for places that have had to go completely digital. And we have had to do that to a certain extent. So I've worked from home quite a lot, and a lot of our sort of office teams have had to get to grips with suddenly the whole digital world. But our sites are all classed as part of the essential service. Okay. You know, people need people. They need the bin men to come and pick up their waste.
Which yeah, absolutely. We have to process it.
So most of our facilities have been open all the way through the lockdowns. And yeah, a lot of our efforts had to go into making them COVID secure and helping people to socially distance. We do have members of the public as well to try and manage. So I think the biggest impact to us probably has been the challenge of remaining open safely.
Sure.
But the digital side of it has been a factor, but just not as much as for other industries, I think.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And like I said earlier, when it comes to, you know, funerals, the waste industry is an essential thing that we all have to deal with every day. But I mean, on a personal note, what have you done to get yourself through this weird year, over a year that we've been experiencing with COVID? Because I think so many people have individually experienced hardships financially, you know, mental health has suffered. What do you do to keep yourself grounded and happy? I mean, because I assume you're not YouTubing waste industry videos when you're in your spare time, although you may do, I don't know. What do you do to, you know, unwind? What do you do to keep yourself, you know, grounded during these weird times?
So I think, I guess I'm a lot more lucky than a lot of people in that I've been able to work throughout. So I guess the advice that I would offer comes from that context. You know, I've not been one of these unfortunate people that's been out of work for months, and I think I'd probably feel differently if I was. But one of the things, I mean, I really, really like to travel, and I really like to explore new places. And so that's impacted me quite a lot with not being able to go very far. But I'm quite a glass half full kind of person, really. And I've tried to set myself a little challenge. I work really well with challenges if I need to keep busy or keep occupied. So I set myself a little challenge to explore locally. And every weekend I try to go somewhere different, locally different, not breaking the rules. Just get that out of there. And while I'm out exploring, if I was on holiday or exploring somewhere kind of new and exciting, I'd take some holiday pictures. So my little challenge is go and explore somewhere new and try and take holiday pictures, because I think then it makes you appreciate the place a little bit more.
Yeah.
And that's really worked really well for me. And I found some great new local places. So that would be one of my tips. Try and imagine you're on holiday locally.
No, I love that. And, you know, create a scrapbook or do the activity with the family or with the kids, you know, and bring it into sort of almost the homeschooling, which is the dreaded word that, you know, very much in prevalent in our household at the moment. And, you know, speaking of homeschooling, I have a 5-year-old and he misses his friends. He misses seeing, you know, grandparents. And we have now been thrust with full force back into homeschooling again. Now, I know last time we met, you know, before the first lockdown, we were talking about the national curriculum and you actually mentioned that waste hierarchy is part of the national curriculum. Now, I had no clue about this. But, you know, for listeners who are stuck now with homeschooling and are looking for something to do on the weekend when perhaps they can't go to a local place because the rain, you know, the terrible weather. I mean, do you have any tips or any sort of fun projects that a family could do at home?
Yeah, definitely. I've got loads. although I haven't got to homeschool, so I don't have that difficulty to face.
Yeah, I'm not sure how your dog would respond to homeschooling.
maybe not brilliantly. like you said, the waste hierarchy and recycling is now part of the national curriculum, which I think is really great. So schools are trying to teach kids about how to do recycling. Mm. So I'd probably set something around the waste hierarchy. And at the top of the waste hierarchy, you've got what's sort of perceived as the best for the environment, and then the different options work down. So we've got at the top, reduce, reuse, recycle. Okay. And they're all things that we could all try and impact on our day-to-day life. So reduce would be reducing the amount of things that you buy, really, reducing what comes into your home, because then you don't need to throw it out.
Yeah.
So for example, thinking about whether you really need that new jumper, if your old jumper hasn't worn out. Personally, I find that very difficult to live
with. Yeah, me too. And my husband can attest to that with the amount of steady new parcels arriving in the door every day.
Yeah. So top of the waste hierarchy, it is difficult for most of us. But next down, you've got reuse.
Okay.
So I think I'm slightly better at reusing, although I am trying quite hard with the reduce.
Yeah.
And reuse would be about finding, like, repurposing something, finding a new use for it. Mm-hmm. So I do try and do a little bit of buying or selling secondhand sometimes, because I feel like it's not really buying new, maybe a bit better.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm all about buying pre-loved, you know, things that someone's loved and passing on to a new experience, and also having big clear outs, especially during all these lockdowns. I think the whole nation, especially in the first lockdown, was like, right, we're going through our cupboards, we're going to get rid of anything we don't use. So I guess that's a really positive step in that direction.
Yeah. So I think I'm probably better at reuse. But yeah, so repurposing it, giving something a new life, you know, turning your old shoe boxes into drawer storage instead of buying drawer storage, for example.
Yeah.
Then you've got recycle, which we've talked about a little bit. So that's making sure the things that you can recycle don't go in your black bag bin and sending them off to be repurposed in something new.
Sure.
So I'd really love people to try and teach their kids about those three, reduce, reuse, recycle. Maybe get them involved in thinking about what could they reduce, reuse, recycle. One of the exercises that we sometimes do with kids is getting a pile of things that you might throw away, mm-hmm. and getting them to sort them into different categories. So teaching children, you know, these are all plastic, this is all paper. And they go in their little piles, and then teaching them what can actually go in the recycling bin would be really useful. Kids surprisingly quite like the sorting game. I mean, I not being a child, didn't think it sounded that exciting, but surprisingly they really like it.
Yeah, no, I think it definitely appeals to children, because Noah likes, you know, my little one likes putting things into order. He likes lining things up, he likes separating things, puts all the T-Rexes together, all the Triceratopses together, you know, he's very specific with his dinosaur ID. But so I can totally see how that would appeal. And then in essence, it's a learning game, because you're teaching children about recycling in essence and how to start sorting it.
Yeah, so maybe try that one with Noah. He might be really good at that. another game, another exercise for people that are feeling slightly more adventurous. I personally love this, and obviously I'm an adult, I still think it's brilliant, is teaching children how to recycle paper.
Okay.
So we obviously just put the paper in our recycling bin, and most people probably don't think any further about what actually happens to it. But you can recycle paper into new paper, and you can sort of replicate that at home with your kids. Do you want me to explain how you
can do that? Tell me, I'm intrigued. I'm taking notes.
Okay, so find your paper that you would otherwise be throwing out.
Okay.
Shred it up as small as you can into little pieces and soak it in water. Mm-hmm. Ideally, you'd want to leave it in at least overnight, but if you're really in a rush, you can kind of vaguely do it with a few hours. And then what you need to do is either mush it up with, well, get your kids to mush it up with their hands, or if you've got a blender, it works really well if you pour the paper after you've soaked it into the blender with a little bit of the water, okay. Mush it up until it's quite smooth. And then you've got a kind of paper pulp, which is basically what the paper mills would do when they're recycling the paper as well.
Okay.
And then you want to take the pulp out of the blender or out of the bowl that you've got it in and sort of spread it out. So I would spread it out on a sheet of old newspaper or something. And then you want to squeeze the water out of it. Mm-hmm. So you could put something like a baking tray on top and push down to squeeze as much water as you can out.
Yeah.
And then you leave it to dry. And in essence, you then have recycled paper. But you can really make it a little bit more creative. So I like to, before you spread it out to squeeze everything out of it, you could dye it with food colouring. So you could have different colours of paper. You could add some seeds into it and then your paper would sprout, which is really cool. But you could add like glitter or flowers and things, all sorts into it. The best one that I've ever seen actually was a very creative child who had different colours of mushed up paper pulp, and then they created a picture out of the colours before they squeezed it down. So then their recycled paper was basically a picture.
That's lovely. Oh, I love that. It's like firing up the imagination, and literally you can do it at home because we all have paper that we are putting in the recycling. So, but it must be clean and not a pizza box with no
but it's really nice because you're teaching, that's how the paper mills recycle in essence, although theirs is slightly more advanced than our home version. And you're also reusing something that you would be throwing out.
I love that. I'm going to do that with Noah. I think that's brilliant. Now we're going to move on to a quick fire round question. So if you haven't prepared for this, you don't know it's coming. What's going to happen is I'm going to say two words and just say the word that you feel most drawn to. You don't need to give me an explanation unless you want to. If you'd like to, please do. But don't think about it too much. Don't worry about what you say. Just answer what you think. So I might say, for example, cats or dogs, and you would say?
Dogs.
Yeah, guess that one was coming. Okay, right, ready, let's go. Morning or night?
Morning.
Netflix or party?
Netflix.
Fish or chips?
Chips.
Starter or dessert?
Ooh. Oh, that's a tough one. Dessert.
Recycle or black bin?
Recycle.
Yay. Brad or Angelina?
Angelina.
Rain or sun?
Sun.
Sea or swimming pool?
Sea.
Fast or slow?
Fast.
Violin or cello?
Violin.
Sweet or savoury?
Sweet.
Eggs or bacon?
Oh, can I not have both? Eggs.
Britney or Madonna?
Madonna.
Gold or silver?
Gold.
Today or tomorrow?
Today.
Amazing. Thank you, Jacqui. So I mean, look, I could talk to you all day. I miss you. I wish we could hang out. We will see each other soon, I'm sure. But before we wrap up, I wondered, you know, you've had this incredible career, like you say, you fell into it, you didn't plan your life, but now you're in this fascinating industry which is continually evolving and changing. So, you know, what do you believe it takes to succeed? What is life all about?
Oh, that's a difficult question. I I think for me, I think the most important thing to succeed in life, bearing in mind different people have completely different perceptions of what success might look like, I think is a positive attitude, an ability to kind of look on the positive or look for the opportunities, even when life might not seem the best, like during lockdown. So I think positive attitude. And I think the other one, I think is good communication. You know, it's critical in my career, and I suspect it's probably really important in most people's. And not only for your career, but I think also just personally, you know, being able to kind of have a good network of friends or colleagues. I think it's really important, whether you're talking about success in your personal life or success in your career.
Yeah, and they're both interlinked at the end of the day, aren't you? You can't be successful in career and fail miserably at all your personal life, because it's going to affect your career in the long run, you know? And and I think this year and COVID has taught us that that communication with our friends, our family, our loved ones is perhaps even more important than everything else, because we've been stopped from being with humans, and hopefully soon we will be back to some more of, you know, normal existence that we can look forward to. But Jacqui Ross, thank you so much for talking with me today. I literally could talk to you for the next 4 hours or longer. And, you know, thank you so much for sharing with us this incredible industry of the waste and recycling world in which you work. And thank you, Jacqui, for joining us today.
Thank you for having me, Lucy.